740. 740.
Pastor,
yes.
I have a praise for the
Bill.
Lord.
If I don't come back, I won't hear it, and I won't be able to tell them.
Manny,
oh, Manny, right here.
He's done with his chemotherapy, and he's still with us.
Yes.
So, praise the
Lord. Chemotherapy didn't kill him.
No.
No, okay. And neither did the cancer.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Hey, amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Absolutely. 740. Amen. And good morning to people out there on the internet. We are so glad to have you today. Pray that wherever you are in the very center of God's will in your life. We know we have people that are in our own town, and we have people that are in China. But wherever you are, we pray that you have determined to be in the very center of God's will. And the only way that can really happen is if in your life you are applying the word of the Bible to every application of our heart. Today we're going to be looking at life itself, and we are in a time when life is very... it's being tossed about. Is life really sacred, or is it not really sacred? Can we take life, or can we not take life? We're in that gigantic debate, and wherever we find ourselves in that debate, my point today is pretty simple. If you can't prove your opinion with Scripture, you better change your opinion. If Scripture doesn't support your position, then you better abandon it. And we're going to go there. So wherever you are, anywhere in the world, our prayer is that your life is directed not by feeling or emotion or nice pictures or anything else, but directed by the Word of God. That alone is the only place we can really anchor our hearts is in God's Word. So we're glad to have you today. We look forward to every opportunity we have to share with you, dear people. We're glad you're here. We're glad that you join us and are a part of our service. 746. Boy, you can see that by the time I get done in Clark, there will be no voice left at all. Right. Arnold, who leads the singing over in Clark, went to Hawaii for 5 weeks. He left 4 weeks ago. I started leading the singing over there also 4 weeks ago, and I've had this cold exactly 4 weeks. Yeah. So thank you. You carry it well. You carry it very well. When we do the turnaround, a couple over here from Sundance, Wyoming, I think they said. Yep. Somewhere over there. John and Pat?
Pam.
I thought, now it's either Pam or Pat. I'll risk Pat. Well, I got it wrong. That's typical. But John and Pam, and I think the last name Davis.
Yep.
Got that right. They're here from Sundance. And I told them we'll be expecting them every week. So be sure to make them feel welcome. 546. We're just going to, I never do this. We're only going to sing verses 1, 3, and 5. See, I don't ever do that, do I? No. She told me one day, you don't have to sing every single verse. So we're doing 1, 3, and 5. There's within my heart a melody. Kids went home last week, and it sure didn't take long for Welder's Row to get claimed by other people. I look over there, I'm amazed. Yes, I thought that row would be empty this morning. It's already full. It's already full. Went up to Lame Deer this week and met with new high school kids, planning for 12 in the fall. We know you can plan for 12 and end up with 6. Yeah, and 12 is more than Brett can really handle, but somebody's going to cancel, so I'd still take a couple of more. And if we end up with 14 and Brett looks at me and says, well, we'll just have to endure that. Want to thank every one of you who help the welding program in any way. I'm doing that annual bookwork this week that you have to do to send into the government. Our grocery bill last year was $44,000. So in case, those kids eat. Those kids, they really, really eat. We appreciate all the help that you give in making it happen. 762, without the help of God's people, it couldn't happen. It just couldn't happen. So, I met with some wonderful young students Marlin, you know Marlin, Marlin. Well, I got up to lame deer, and the counselor there, the lady counselor, she says, now she says, I got a junior and a sophomore I want you to talk to too. They wish they were old enough to come, but they are both brothers of Marlin. I talked to Marlin's junior brother, and then I talked to his sophomore brother, and they're both looking forward to being here when their turn comes. So what fun, what fun. Ran into a preacher, and he said, I have an 18-year-old who goes to a different school up in Colstrip. Will you call him? So I called him that night. His name was Elijah, and he says, oh, please, can I come? Please, can I come? I said, sure, you can come. So he graduates from Colstrip. That's a school we've never gone to, Justin. We've never gone to Colstrip. So we might get an invite to go to Colstrip. So praise the Lord. 762. And stand with me. 531.
Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. Holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Oh, Lamb. Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Holy, holy, are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, you are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, you are holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. Worthy is the Lamb, you are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb, worthy.
Amen. Thank you. I said we never know what is going to be, what to expect. Thank you. That was wonderful. And it's always been good. Thank you. The Christian and life. The Christian and life. Father, oh Lord, we thank you. You are the author of life. And I pray, Lord, that we would do honor to your word in our attitudes. Pray your blessing upon our discussion today. Pray, Lord, that it might come straight from your word and from your heart. And pray your blessing upon each of us who hear, that we might cement our hearts in your direction. In your name we pray. Amen. The book says that in the end of time there will be a great falling away. A great falling away. And in the last couple of weeks, I've talked about an 80-year avalanche as Christians have simply been giving up one chunk of the faith after another. We have just given up one little piece after another. A correction to be made on Ernest Hemingway. He did not kill himself jumping out of the airplane. He tried twice. But the pilot stopped him both times, apparently. So finally in 1961, he shot himself. Yeah, okay. So now why do you need to know about Ernest Hemingway? Because he wrote a book called The Sun Also Rises. And in that book, one character goes bankrupt and the other character says, and how did that happen? And he responds, well, slowly at first, then all of a sudden. Yeah. And that's what's happened with the disintegration of the church in the last 80 years. We began giving up things little by little back in the 1970s, and then since the rollover of the century, we have just pushed them aside rapidly, much more rapidly than earlier before. So we've seen ourselves, we've seen the people who call themselves Christian take completely different views on important topics than Christians took historically. Today, we look at life itself. The abortion battle is raging across the United States ever since the Supreme Court flipped over Roe versus Wade a couple of years back. So on one side are those people who say, well, it's a woman's own body and she has a right for self-determination and therefore it's nobody's business but her own. And on the other side, the argument that it is life and that it's life given by God and that it's a human being from the moment of conception and to take it is murder. The girl was 16. She was a poor girl in a big city, dragged into a dark alley and raped, soon to find out she was pregnant. The rapist disappeared, was never found. Suddenly, being pregnant, she is surrounded by all of her friends with advice, like Job in his book. And suddenly, there's all kinds of people telling her what a sad situation it is, and that, in fact, the only reasonable thing for her to do is to abort this baby and go on with her life. One person, one alone, made a line that caught her heart. One person said to her, my dear, people can decide when to make love, but God alone decides when to make life. Interesting line. That caught her heart, and she decided she would carry the child. And so she did. She carried the child, and at delivery, it was placed into the hands of a loving couple for her never to see it again. She matured, grew up, married a very godly man, bless her heart, found a very godly man. All you young ladies, it's hard to find godly men today. But don't waste your time on any other. Yeah, if you do, then I can write right across your wedding certificate, regret. Because that will follow. If you don't find a godly man, regret will follow. She found a very godly man, and they proceeded to enter a very godly, wonderful life. They were only saddened by the fact that in over 25 years of marriage, God had never allowed them to have a child. They had never had a child. Imagine her delight when one morning she gets a call from a young lady who says, I think maybe you're my mother. Huh? Think of that. And it was. It was. What a tremendous reunion they enjoyed. And then they traveled the country talking about this very topic and the fact that God alone decides when to make life. God alone decides when to make life. We are plagued with unwanted babies. I mean, we have a surplus, a gigantic surplus, over 1 million a year of unwanted babies. We don't want them. We don't want to make room for them. We don't want to have them. We want rid of them. Is that new? No, that's not new. No. Rome had just as many people who didn't want babies as America has. Rome was full of people who had pregnancies they did not want and babies they didn't want. So abortion was very, very common in Rome. All kinds of techniques and methods used, but abortion was very common. When abortion didn't work, infanticide was completely legal. It was absolutely common for a family with a newborn who didn't want it to simply put it out on the doorstep, outside the front door, and leave it right there. Many were eaten by wild dogs. They put them on trash heaps. In Rome, the head of the household, the man of the household, had the right of life and death over everybody in his home. When his 14-year-old son started smarting off, Dad said, "Are you getting tired of living here?" Yeah, think of that. Yeah, Dad could dispatch his 14-year-old son completely legally in Rome. Wow. Yeah. So it wasn't just abortion. It was paganism running wild. So we get the story then in our scriptures. We get Abraham and Isaac. Abraham is an old man. He finally has a child, Isaac. And God has promised that through this child, God is going to build a great nation. Then, Scripture says, when he was a young lad, we don't know what that means. We picture a 12, 13-year-old kid, young lad. God told Abraham, take your son, your only son, Isaac, take him to a mountain that I will show you and there sacrifice him. He's on his way with his son. When he is asked, we see the wood, we see the fire, where's your sacrifice? And he says, God himself shall supply the sacrifice. Now, human sacrifice was so common in the day of Abraham that God was making a gigantic impression here that that was not going to be the way of God. So that story ends with the ram with his horns caught in the brush, and in fact, that ram becomes a sacrifice. Eventually then, we see the Passover lamb becoming the sacrifice, and then finally we see the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, where he becomes our sacrifice. So God points out early on in Scripture that he does not condone human sacrifice. There's a Bible in front of you, under your seat or someplace. Leviticus chapter 20. And so somebody says, well, you know, I really don't like abortion, but, you know, in a rape case, you know, and they come up with all these different cases. Well, in the day of Moses, unwanted babies were dealt with before the altar of Molech. Molech was a big iron statue with a fire pit right in front of him. And the fire pit was kept boiling with fire, and Molech had his arms out. And babies were thrown into his arms. His arms were held downward. Babies were thrown into his arms. The baby would roll down and into the fire. Naturally, the baby is screaming. So while we're sacrificing the Molech, why, we are dancing and singing loudly to all kinds of great music so we don't hear our children scream their way to death. This is common in Moses' day. So in Leviticus chapter 20, he addresses this topic. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, and he said, give these instructions that apply both to native Israelites and to foreigners living in Israel. If any of them offer their children as a sacrifice to Molech, they must be put to death. Are we talking about the children or the parents? We're talking about the parents. If anybody sacrifices their children to Molech, they must be put to death. The people of the community must stone them to death. I myself will turn against them. I will cut them off from the community because they have defiled my sanctuary and brought shame to my holy name by offering their children to Molech. Hang on. Here comes the next verse. And if the people of the community ignore this, it's not my problem. I haven't got anything to do with it. I'm not opposing it. I mean, I got other things to do. If the people of the community ignore those who offer their children to Molech and refuse to execute them, then I myself will cut them and their families off from the community. This will happen to all who commit spiritual prostitution by worshiping Molech. So if you wonder how God feels about getting rid of unwanted babies, there it is. There it is. There's no argument. There's just not an argument. There just is no argument. Dr. Francis Schaeffer, who was the great theologian of the latter part of the last century, when Roe versus Wade went through, he said at that time, I believe abortion will be the gigantic hinge pin upon which the culture of the world will turn. If, in fact, you can deny one group of people life, then what is to stop you from denying a different group of people life? He said, once we have accepted the abortion of the unborn, then it's easy to accept the infanticide of the imperfect baby or the baby we don't want. And it's equally easy to accept the concept of euthanasia of old people. And we can divide those into categories. We can start with old people who don't know who they are or what they are and have nobody who cares about them. And then we can move downward further and further. That's what he said in the late 1970s. And today it's here. Today it is here. We have it today. Dr. Kevorkian, you remember the name. You kids don't know the name. But anybody that's 35 knows the name. He was the famous doctor in Michigan who began pioneering the way to assisted suicide. I believe, and all you guys with the magic phones can check me out because I was wrong on the airplane suicide. I was sure he succeeded. I was sure Hemingway jumped out and killed himself. Turned out he didn't. So you can check me out on this one. I think Kevorkian served a few months in jail for, or at least some time period, I think. Okay, my historian's shaking his head, yes. Okay, several of them are. Okay, so I'm going to vote that I'm right there then. Yeah, he served some time in jail for doing a suicide assist in Michigan. But of course, that was a long time ago, and things began to change. So we have suicide to look at. Now, abortion is clearly murder. But suicide? Surely that's a different category. Now, this is an emotionally charged discussion because most of us have somebody that we were connected to, that we loved, who did it. And therefore, we want to believe they're in heaven. Well, okay. I don't blame you. I have some people in that category. I would like to see that happen too. Now, when you ask people, why do you, and I was, I went to the service of a young man who had taken his own life. The pastor that day pointed out, he said, I think that was a very dumb thing for him to do. But I am confident that today he is in heaven playing checkers with Jesus. I thought, playing checkers with Jesus. I have the notion that if I end up in heaven, I am not going to be asking to play checkers. I am going to be falling on my knees and saying, oh God, thank you, Lord Jesus, for accepting me, the wreck that I am. I'm not going to be sitting there saying, hey, old buddy, I just kinged you, you know. But that was what the preacher said. I'm confident that he's in heaven playing checkers with Jesus right now. Well, what makes you think so? And when you ask that question, I can tell you the answer you're going to get. The answer is always the same. It's, well, I think God is an understanding God. That's pretty pathetic scripture. I think God, that's pathetic scripture. God says, you don't even have a concept of how I think. He said, my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts, and you don't have a clue, buddy. That's an awfully poor scripture to base a very significant opinion on. Well, I think God. No, no, no. If you're, we're talking, we're not talking about going to lunch at the Mexican restaurant. We're talking about people killing themselves with eternity moments ahead of them. It's important that we know what Scripture has to say, okay? So, if you want to support suicide as being a Christian activity, don't waste your time looking for scriptural support. You're not going to find any. It's just not there. There's just none there. Now, the Catholic Church for 2,000 years has had no difficulty with their doctrine. They simply say it's murder. And once you're dead, you can't ask for forgiveness. That's the bottom line in their discussion. The Protestant Church believed the same thing from the opening days of the Reformation until about 1970. But from about 1970 on, we began to, well, I'm not so sure, you know, maybe, you know. And granted, it's a very difficult topic to gain great spiritual and scriptural direction on. I've tried. I believe, and I, you can check me again because I didn't look it up, but I believe, I mean, when I researched that, 8 or 9 years ago, I believe I came up with 7 people in the Bible who ended their own life. And of course, we can all think of Saul, and we can think of Samson. They were hardly suicides, even though they were kind of technically suicide. And then there was Judas, and of course, we all know where we think Judas ended up. But then I think there were 4 others, but I no longer remember exactly what that is. So here we are. In the Protestant church in the last 50 years or 70 years, we've begun to take this approach, well, I don't think God would really send somebody to hell who committed suicide. Well, okay, I'm going to refer to John Bunyan, who wrote The Pilgrim's Progress in 1678, 350 years ago. He wrote The Pilgrim's Progress, considered by nearly the whole world as the greatest allegory ever written. He didn't even write it. I mean, there's about a 3-page explanation in the front of the book as to why he wrote it. He didn't write it for you. He didn't write it to publish. He wrote it because he was in jail for 10 years because he wouldn't accept the king's decree of how he had to worship God. So he wrote it for himself. It's an allegory. I struggle with allegories. But there are three men working their way through life into the celestial city, heaven. And two of them are Christian and hopeful. Christian and hopeful are on their way. They're moving toward heaven. And they encounter all of the great temptations that you and I encounter. And along the way, one of the great temptations that they encounter is called the giant despair. The giant despair. Now, most of us have run into despair at some point in our life. You've run into despair. And I suspect that probably 99% of those people who have committed suicide have in fact met the giant despair. And because they have met the giant despair, they take his advice. I say this often down at the jail. Satan is the accuser of the brethren, right? And at the jail, I frequently say, hey, tell me, has Satan ever told you what a worthless human being you are? And nearly always, yes. Well, you need to know he's told me that too. I'm just as worthless. And in fact, at some point, he tells most of us, why don't you just end it all? You're not worth anything anyway. Well, that's what's happening here. I'll read this. In my book, it's page 152. But, brother, said Christian, what shall we do? The life we're now living is miserable. Now he quotes Job. He says, as for me, this comes right out of Job chapter 7, I don't know whether it's best to live like this or to die quickly. I prefer strangling to death rather than to live in this body of mine. And the grave seems more easy for me than this dungeon of despair. Hopeful spoke. He says, our present condition is indeed dreadful. And death would be far more welcome to me than to stay like this forever. But let us consider that the Lord of the country to which we are going has said, you shall not murder. Exodus chapter 20, verse 13. No, not to murder another person. Much more then, are we forbidden to take the giant's advice to kill ourselves. Besides, he who kills someone else can only commit murder of that person's body. But for one to kill himself is to kill both the body and the soul at the same time. Wow. Well, that's just a novel. Yeah. One thing about his novel is that every paragraph is footnoted with scripture, and so now we'll look at the scripture that he footnotes in that particular case. We looked at Exodus. I told you Exodus chapter 20 and verse 13, thou shalt not kill. Go to Matthew chapter 10, verse 28. Matthew chapter 10. Don't be afraid of those who want to kill your body. They cannot touch your soul. Fear only God, who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Okay, well, that, all right, I don't have any problem with that, but that doesn't really address suicide, okay? But he's using it in his argument as he goes along. Go to 1 Corinthians, now that you've finally caught up to me and found Matthew chapter 10. Hurry over to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. This one's hard to get around. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. I'm going to read it in the Living. Don't you realize that all of you together are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God lives in you? God will destroy anyone who destroys this temple. That's pretty straightforward. For God's temple is holy, and you are that temple. Wow. That's pretty plain. So you say, then you tell, do you really believe that a person can be a Christian and be 90 years old and they can commit suicide and end up in hell? Do you really believe that, Kurt? Yeah. Well, I don't. Oh. Well, that proves we can both think. So if I'm wrong, what have I lost? No big deal. If you're wrong. If you're wrong. This is the biggest game of Russian roulette you could ever play. You could never play a bigger game of Russian roulette. You're talking about all of eternity. You say, well, doesn't matter. I have no plan to kill myself anyway. Wonderful. That's wonderful. Your problem is that your doctor may think otherwise. Huh? 10 states plus the District of Columbia now have assisted suicide. It'll never come to Wyoming. Never is a long time. Canada legalized it in 2015. Canada's got the same problem every country's got. They have a lowered birth rate. We don't want anybody to have babies. We abort them all. And they have an aging population. And this brings about an economic strain. We have fewer young people to support more old people. We got a problem here. And so in 2015, Canada legalized assisted suicide. Now the problem that they're having in Canada is that people that don't want to die are being told to kill themselves. Of course, in Canada, we claim to take care of people from the cradle to the grave, right? So one lady requests a wheelchair ramp, and the social worker said, I can give you the medicines to kill yourself, and then you won't need a wheelchair ramp. Yeah. Canada's full of this right now. Canada is so full of this. They're unbelievably full of it. They have now moved to include veterans with PTSD. We are even working on, that's not legal yet, but we are working on making suicide available to mature minors who are depressed, as well as seriously addicted drug users. This year, 25% of all the people who die in Canada will die because of assisted suicide. 25%. And it's only been there since 2015. Many people have come to the point now where loved ones have to fight to keep the medical personnel from overpowering the patient with all of the, you need to do the world a favor, you need to do the world a favor, you need to do the world a favor. The Netherlands is working on a bill right now for what they call a completed life pill. Everybody over 70 is entitled to receive the completed life pill, which will kill you in seconds. Yeah. Yeah. That's what the Netherlands... There's a Japanese professor. I can't say his name, so I'm just going to let you know he's a professor. He actually works at Yale University, but he loves his home country of Japan, spends a great deal of time in Japan, and for Japan... Japan's got a real problem because they have a lot more old people and very few young people. So he is recommending a ceremony where old people all line up on the edge of a cliff. And to the sound of music, We all leap at once. We all leap at once. Some of you remember Levon's father many, many years ago now, but he came and he preached to us. Levon's father was still preaching at 88 years old and still carrying a full docket of on the road, driving himself from Georgia to Texas for one revival meeting after another at 88 years old. He got a urinary tract infection. He had a few weeks off between Thanksgiving and Christmas. So he was at home, got a urinary tract infection. Levon kept telling him, "Dad, you got to go to the doctor." "Oh," he says, "it'll go, it'll go, and I got other work to do." All of a sudden, Christmas Day, he passed out. He was at the home of another person. They called the ambulance. Immediately, he was hauled off to the hospital. I mean, sirens blowing, and I mean, we're in a big hurry. Whoever he was with called us. We got the news, you know, before he was even at the hospital, we knew it. And we began working to get ourselves there, but it would be 24 hours before we actually were able to stand in the hospital room beside his bed. Now, he had one of those living wills which said no heroic measures. He wanted no machinery attached to him to keep him alive. Okay? Levon walks into the room. He's getting nothing. He's been there 24 hours. He has been given nothing. There's no IV running. He's unconscious. He's not had a pill. He's not had a shot. He's not had anything in 24 hours. Why didn't they leave him laying in the house? Why run the ambulance? Why waste the money? Hey, every minute that he's in that bed, we're clocking up dollars from Medicare. The old counters are rolling. Levon's distraught. Oh, we'll send a social worker in. Oh, you should have seen the way she ground up that social worker. I'll tell you what. That social worker didn't want to talk to Levon for more than 30 seconds. I mean, that social worker went out of there. Just, I mean, she was carrying her skirt and running when she left, man. She was on the run. 20 seconds later, the doctor arrives. "Now, ma'am, let me explain a few things here to you." That was the wrong way to start with my wife. That guy got talked to like a 14-year-old that stole the car. He had never been told, he says, "You may want to kill my father, but I'm not going to help you kill my father." No heroic measures does not include not giving him some antibiotic to fight infection. You haven't given him one thing for fluids to feed him. All you're doing is waiting for him to die. The doctor left almost as quickly as the nurse left, or as a social worker. But the truth of it is, they were just waiting for him to die. And 24 hours later, they accomplished that. Now, they immediately started plugging him in. Woo, man, I mean, it wasn't 5 minutes after that doctor left the room, then all of a sudden, there was all kinds of little carts with bottles on them arriving in the hall, coming on, and they're plugging him in. It's a little too late. So our culture is going that way. But you need to know where you stand. Once they get to the point where they no longer are talking about assisted suicide but required murder, well, your soul's fine. They can murder you. That's not going to have anything to do with it. But for you to make that decision, John Bunyan says, that's a poor decision to make. I'm going to vote with John Bunyan. Stand with me. I'm going to vote with John Bunyan. His book has stood the test of time for 350 years. I got a brilliant line here at the last. I got to read you this brilliant. It took me a long time to think of this. It was the Christian view of life that overwhelmed paganism in Rome. And as Christians abandon that view in a modern world, paganism will return. That's where we're at. Father, oh Lord, we love you today. And I pray that every attitude we have, Father, needs to be based on Scripture, not on I think. I pray, Lord, we will find Scripture to support any and every position we take in our life and in the way we live. May we respect life as you respect life. You are the giver and the taker. Job pointed that out. And Father, we were made in your image. This is not something to take lightly. Father, we love you. Dismiss us in your name, we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Amen. We got one more of these hard ones next week.